he is suffering as a naked ascetic, and yet cannot attain anything. So he asked Citta to bring him to ordain. Then Citta, the householder, took the naked ascetic Kasapa to the elder monks and said to them, "Venerable sirs, this naked ascetic Kasapa is an old friend of ours from lay life. Let the elders give him the going forth. Let them give him the higher ordination. I will be zealous in providing him with robes, arms, food, lodging, and medicinal requisites." Then the naked ascetic Kasapa received the going forth in this Dhamma Vinaya. He received the higher ordination. And soon, not long after his higher ordination, dwelling alone, withdrawn, diligent, ardent, and resolute, the Venerable Kasapa, by realizing it for himself with direct knowledge, in this very life, entered and dwelt in that unsurpassed goal of the holy life, for the sake of which clansmen rightly go forth from the household life into homelessness. He directly knew, destroyed his birth, the holy life has been lived, what had to be done has been done, there is no more for this state of being, and the Venerable Kasapa became one of the Arahants. So here he says, soon, not long after his higher ordination, he attained Arahanthood. This soon, not long after his higher ordination, would be at least a few years, because normally he has to train under a teacher for at least 5 years. And then after that, he's allowed to go and live alone and do his work very hard to attain liberation. So normally, during the Buddha's time, monks would take at least more than 10 years or 20 years and then become Arahants. But there are, of course, exceptions like Sariputta and Moggallana and Mahakasapa and all that. The next sutta, 41.10. Now on that occasion, Citta, the householder, was sick, afflicted, gravely ill. Citta was dying. Then a number of park devatas, grove devatas, tree devatas, and devatas dwelling in medicinal herbs and forest giants assembled and said to Citta the householder, "Make a wish, householder. Make a wish thus. May I become a wheel-turning monarch in the future." Stop here for a moment. This wheel-turning monarch is a universal monarch. That means he rules over the whole earth. The whole earth wants him to become the king. And this was said, Citta the householder said to those devatas, "That too is impermanent, that too is unstable. One must abandon that too and pass on." So Citta is saying, even that state of a wheel-turning monarch, although it's such a happy state, but it is impermanent, even that will pass away. When this was said, Citta, the householder's friends and companions, relatives and kinsmen said to him, "Set up mindfulness, master, don't babble." And he said, "What did I say that makes you speak to me thus?" And they said, "You said to us, that too is impermanent, that too is unstable. One must abandon that too and pass on." Let's stop here for a moment. So these friends and relatives, they could not see the devas speaking to Citta. So they thought he was out of his mind, his mind was not stable. So he's simply babbling, simply talking nonsense. And he said, "That was because park devatas, grove devatas, tree devatas, and devatas dwelling in medicinal herbs and forest giants assembled and said to me, 'Make a wish, householder, thus. May I become a wheel-turning monarch in the future.' And I said to them, 'That too is impermanent, that too is unstable. One must abandon that too and pass on.' And they asked him, 'What advantage do those devatas see, master, that they speak to you thus?' And he said, 'It occurs to those devatas, this Citta, the householder, is virtuous, of good character. If he should wish, may I become a wheel-turning monarch in the future. As he is virtuous, this wish of his could succeed because of its purity. The righteous king of righteousness will provide righteous offerings.' Seeing this advantage, those devatas assembled and said, 'Make a wish, householder, thus. May I become a wheel-turning monarch in the future? And I said to them, that too is impermanent, that too is unstable. One must abandon that too and pass on. I stop here for a moment. So Chitta said, these devas, they thought that Chitta, if he makes a wish, he can become a wheel-turning king. And if he becomes a wheel-turning king, he's such a good person, then he will ask the people to make offerings to all these devatas. So that's why they thought it's good if he can become a king, and humans will make offerings to these devatas. And his friends and relatives said to Chitta, then exhort us too, householder. Ask him to advise them also. And he said, therefore, you should train yourselves thus. We will be possessed of confirmed confidence in the Buddha. That means saddha, unshakable confidence in the Buddha thus. The Blessed One is an arahant, perfectly enlightened, accomplished in true knowledge and conduct, fortunate knower of the world, unsurpassed leader of persons to be tamed, teacher of devas and humans, the enlightened one, the Blessed One. We will be possessed of confirmed confidence in the Dhamma thus. The Dhamma is well expounded by the Blessed One, directly visible, immediate, inviting one to come and see, applicable to be personally experienced by the wise. We will be possessed of confirmed confidence in the Sangha thus. The Sangha of the Blessed One's disciples is practicing the good way, practicing the straight way, practicing the true way, practicing the proper way, that is, the four pairs of persons, the eight types of individuals. This Sangha of the Blessed One's disciples is worthy of gifts, worthy of hospitality, worthy of offerings, worthy of reverential salutation, the unsurpassed field of merit for the world. Whatever there may be in our family that can be given away, all that we will share unreservedly with the virtuous ones who are of good character. It is in such a way that you should train yourselves. Then, having inspired confidence in the Buddha, the Dhamma, and the Sangha among his friends and colleagues, his relatives and kinsmen, and having exhorted them in generosity, Chitta, the householder, passed away. That's the end of the sutta. So he was reborn in the Sudavasa heavens, which is the fourth jhana heaven, because he had attained the third fruit, Anagamin. But later, I think he came back to see the Buddha. Many of the Buddha's disciples, after they had gone to heaven, they remember the Buddha. They still come back to see him. So we are finished with chapter 41. Now we went through every of the 10 suttas, which was quite interesting. Now we come to chapter 42, Gamani Sanyutta. Gamani means the headman, what we call the penghulu, the village headman. At Savati, this is the first sutta, 42.1. These suttas are also very interesting. 42.1, at Savati. Then the headman, Chanda, the wrathful, approached the Blessed One, the angry man, paid homage to him, sat down to one side and said to him, Venerable Sir, what is the cause and reason why someone here is reckoned as wrathful? And what is the cause and reason why someone here is reckoned as gentle? Maybe he asked this question because people call him the wrathful, the angry man. And the Buddha said, Hear, headman, someone has not abandoned lust. Because he has not abandoned lust, other people irritate him. Being irritated by others, he manifests irritation. He is reckoned as wrathful. He has not abandoned hatred. Because he has not abandoned hatred, other people irritate him. Being irritated by others, he manifests irritation. He is reckoned as wrathful. He has not abandoned delusion. Because he has not abandoned delusion, other people irritate him. Being irritated by others, he manifests irritation. He is reckoned as wrathful. This headman is the cause and reason why someone here is reckoned as wrathful. Hear, headman, someone has abandoned lust. Because he has abandoned lust, other people do not irritate him. Not being irritated by others, he does not manifest irritation. He is reckoned as gentle. He has abandoned hatred. Because he has abandoned hatred, other people do not irritate him. Not being irritated by others, he does not manifest irritation. He is reckoned as gentle. He has abandoned delusion. Because he has abandoned delusion, other people do not irritate him. Not being irritated by others, he does not manifest irritation. He is reckoned as gentle. This headman is the cause and reason why someone here is reckoned as gentle. When this was said, Chanda, the headman, said to the Blessed One, Magnificent Venerable Sir, Magnificent Venerable Sir, the Dhamma has been made clear in many ways by the Blessed One. As though he were turning upright what had been turned upside down, revealing what was hidden, showing the way to one who was lost, or holding up a lamp in the dark for those with eyesight to see forms. I go for refuge to the Blessed One, and to the Dhamma, and to the Bhikkhu Sangha. From today, let the Blessed One remember me as a lay follower who has gone for refuge for life. So here the Buddha says that a person, if he has lust, hatred, and delusion, so because of these unwholesome states, he irritates other people. And so other people irritate him in return. So when other people irritate him in return, he becomes angry. That's why he's called wrathful, angry person. Whereas another person, if he has abandoned lust, hatred, and delusion, then he does not irritate others. And other people, not being irritated by him, will not irritate him back. So he does not get angry. So because of that, he's called a gentle person. The next sutta. Next sutta is quite a well-known sutta. 42.2. On one occasion, the Blessed One was dwelling at Rajagaha in the bamboo grove, the squirrel sanctuary. Then Talaputta, the troop headman, approached the Blessed One, paid homage to him, sat down to one side and said to him, Venerable Sir, I have heard it said among actors of old in the lineage of teachers, if an actor in the theater or the arena entertains and amuses people by truth and lies, then with the breakup of the body after death, he is reborn in the company of the laughing devas. What does the Blessed One say about that? And the Buddha said, Enough, headman, let it be. Don't ask me that. A second and a third time, Talaputta, the troop headman, said to the Buddha, Venerable Sir, I have heard it said among actors of old, in the lineage of teachers, if an actor in the theater or the arena entertains and amuses people by truth and lies, then with the breakup of the body after death, he is reborn in the company of the laughing devas. What does the Blessed One say about that? Stop here for a moment. This Talaputta is the head of this show people, you know what we call Tai Hei, Tua Hei. They go around from village to village, putting up shows for people, and they entertain people, make people laugh and all that. So he says, people tell him, because he is the manager, he is also an actor, and he entertains people, so because makes people laugh, he says, can go to heaven, become a laughing deva. Buddha said, don't ask me, but he continued to ask three times. Then the Buddha said, surely, headman, I am not getting true to you when I say, enough, headman, let it be, don't ask me that. But still I will answer you. So here the Buddha said, I told you not to ask me, but you still asked me three times. So generally, if a person requests the Buddha three times, then he will yield. In the theater or arena, among beings who are not yet free from lust, who are bound by the bondage of lust, an actor entertains them with titillating things that excite them even more strongly to lust. In the theater or arena, among beings who are not yet free from hatred, who are bound by the bondage of hatred.